So we have seen how the use of a clever data structure, the union find data structure, can make Kruskal's algorithm more efficient. The other two algorithms which we need to make efficient are Dijkstra's algorithm for the single source shortest path and Prim's algorithm for the minimum cost spanning tree. Both of them, it turns out, require a data structure that is usually called a priority queue. So to understand priority queues, let's look at the following scenario. So supposing we have a job scheduler running on an operating system. So when we run multiple tasks on an operating system, each of them runs for a little bit of time and then is swapped out. So a job scheduler maintains a list of all jobs which are pending along with their priorities. Whenever the processor is free, the scheduler picks out a job with the maximum priority in the list and schedules it. Now what happens, of course, is this is dynamic, right? So while some jobs are running, other new jobs may arrive. So at each time when new jobs arrive, they will come with different priorities, and this is the job of the scheduler to make sure that the new jobs with higher priority come ahead of older jobs with lower priority. So from a data structure point of view, our question is, what is the best way for the scheduler to maintain the list of pending jobs with their priorities so that this list can be updated dynamically as this list gets updated, as new jobs arrive? So this is what we call a priority queue. So we have two basic operations in a priority queue. The first is to extract the next job, which in this case means take the job with the highest priority and remove it from the queue. Now, of course, we have a situation where you have multiple jobs with the same priority, so we don't assume that the priorities are unique. But if they are not unique, then we can assume either that there is some tie-breaking rule or we don't care which one of the highest priority jobs you get. Right? So the main operation is delete max. Delete the maximum priority item from the queue. And then there is an insert. So a job will come, it will be inserted, it will come with a priority. So we need to insert it into the list so that subsequent delete max take this one into account. So the first solution that one could think of to keep such such data is to maintain a list, some kind of a linear structure, an array or a list. Since it's growing dynamically, a list is the obvious choice. Now, if we keep an unsorted list, then it's easy to add a job, right? We just have to append it to the list. So insertion is a constant time operation. It takes time O1. But as we have seen many times, if we have an unsorted list, then we have to scan the entire list to find the minimum or the maximum. So in this case, if we want to do a delete max from an unsorted list, this operation is going to take us linear time proportional to the size of the list or the number of jobs that are pending at the moment. So the only useful thing one can do with the list otherwise is to sort it. So if we sort it, we can try and maintain the jobs in decreasing order of priority. If we do it in decreasing order of priority, then the maximum priority job is always at the beginning of the list. So we can instantly find it in constant time. So delete max now becomes a constant time operation. But then what happens to insert? Right? We need to insert a value into the list. And as we saw with insertion sort, when we insert a value into a sorted list, we have to walk down the list to find the correct place to put it in. So that will now take order in time. Right? So between an unsorted list and a sorted list, we have a trade-off. In an unsorted list, delete max takes linear time. In a sorted list, insert takes linear time. So one or the other is a bottleneck. Right? So whether we use an unsorted list or a sorted list, over a sequence of n jobs, supposing n jobs arrive in the system and we process them, then we will be inserting them n times and deleting max n times. So whichever solution we use among these two, we will end up spending order n squared time. So this suggests to us that a linear structure, a one-dimensional structure, has a severe limitation with respect to solving the representation of a priority queue in an efficient way. So we have to go from a one-dimensional structure to a two-dimensional structure. So let us start with a very naive two-dimensional structure just to show how we can get drastic improvements just by moving from one dimension to two dimensions. So here we assume that we know in advance somehow a bound on the number of total jobs we can have. So we have assumed in this case, say that n is 25. So now what we do is instead of maintaining a one-dimensional list of length 25, maximum length 25, we reorganize this list as a square array of 5 by 5, so square root n by square root n. So now you can see here an example of such a thing. So we have 25 minus 6, 19 jobs currently with different priorities in there. Okay, sometimes two jobs may have the same priority, that doesn't matter. But the important thing is that we are not necessarily maintaining it in a kind of sequential way through this two-dimensional array. All we are guaranteeing is that every row, as we look at the row from left to right, is in ascending order. Right? So we have the first row is in ascending order, second row is, but the rows themselves have nothing in common with each other. So you could have bigger values in the second row than the smaller row and vice versa. So say, so for example, 19 is bigger than 12, but then 17 is bigger than 8 and so on. Right? So these are kind of five independent lists of jobs which together make up the total set of jobs, and each list is sorted. So now suppose we want to insert a new job into this list. So the strategy is very simple. We want to insert it in the correct place in the first row that has free space. Now to find out if one of the rows has free space, we need to walk down this thing to find out how many elements are there. So we will save that work by keeping this extra information here, which is the size of each of the rows, right? So let's assume that we have the size available of each of the rows. Now we know in this particular case that each row is of size 5 at most. So if the size is 5, right, then we know that if we try to insert 11 into this first row, right, that 11 will not be able to fit there because there is no space basically. So then we move to the next row. Once again we see that the size is 5, so then we go to the third row. And now we see that there is a space because there are only 3 elements in this row and it can take 5. So now we walk down this list and find the correct place to insert it and insert it as we do in insertion sort. Right? So now the question is, how much time does this take? Well, we know that we have square root of n rows. Right? So it takes square root of n steps to find the correct row to insert going from top to bottom. And then we have in each row square root of n entries. So if we do our usual insertion, it takes time proportional to the length of the row we are inserting into. So we have a square root of n scan to find the correct row, a square root of n scan to find the correct position within that row. So overall, it is time order of square root of n. Right? So what about deleting? Right? So we want to delete the maximum element in this array. Now, because each row is independent of the other row, we don't know in advance where this maximum element is. However, we do know that in every row, the maximum element is at the end because each row is sorted. Okay? So the first thing we do know is that every possible maximum element is actually at the end of its row. Okay? So we have these five rows, we have five maximum elements, and now the overall maximum must be among these five elements, it must be the largest one. So we can just use the size information. So we know it's the fifth element in the first row, the fifth element in the second row, the fourth element in the third and fourth row, and the second element in the last row. So using the size information, we can scan through all of these, right, and identify which is the biggest one. In this case, it is 43. Right? So we identify that 43 needs to be deleted. Okay? And then having deleted 43, then we remove it. And then of course, we have to also reduce the size back from 4 to 3. Okay, so we can keep track of the size as and when we manipulate. In the previous example also, when we had increased 11, we made this 3 into 4. Okay, so again, it's an order root n operation. So we have now achieved a data structure which keeps track of elements in a priority queue, where insert takes order root n time, delete max takes order root n time, and therefore now processing a sequence of n jobs takes n root n time. Okay, remember that previously it was order n squared. So we have reduced from order n squared to order n 3 by 2 if you want to write it this way. Okay? So this is just a sampler to explain that a two-dimensional structure can give you significant savings over a linear structure. So of course we are not going to be happy with this, otherwise we would have just stopped with this. So we can actually do much better than n to the 3 by 2, and this is what we are going to discuss in a later lecture. To give you a preview, what we are going to do is to maintain it not in a simple array or a square matrix like this, but in a special kind of binary tree called a heap. Okay? So this will be a binary tree, so it will have a structure like this, and it will be balanced. So basically all the paths will roughly have the same length, and what this will mean is that the height of the tree, okay, will be logarithmic in the size of the tree. And this will make both insert and delete max take log n operations. And this will give an overall bound for n operations of n log n. The other thing is that we actually maintain it as a dynamic tree like this. We don't have to make an assumption as we did in our simple solution that we just proposed, where we upper bound n. Right? right? We can have a solution where the tree can grow as large as we want, so long as we make sure that we grow it in a systematic way to keep it balanced. Okay, so this is what we will look at next. We will look at this data structure called a heap, which implements a priority queue by maintaining a type of binary tree.